Sadly, I don't have MC to introduce me, so I'll introduce myself. My name is SJ, and I'll go through with more introduction later in the introduction slide. First of all, to manage everyone's expectation, in this session, we may not write any single line of code at all. Okay? Just like, unlike the previous session, if you sit in the previous session, it's really very heavy Magento development. But what the topic that I'll go through tonight or this evening is really more on the Drupal way. And there is a way to actually build a complicated Drupal site without actually writing any single line of code. And that's the power of Drupal. Now, we are going to use Drupal 8, and the caveat here is that I'm still learning how to use, how to program using Drupal 8 myself too. So, you sitting there, you may actually know more about Drupal 8 than I do. So, if let's say you know more, please feel free to just share with the rest what you know. Okay, introduction. My name is SJ. I share the same initial as another great man in history, Steve Jobs. But my full name is Solihin Jinata. I'm not that great yet. I hope I will be one day. I'm co-founder at Pixel Onion. Pixel Onion is an award-winning Singapore-based digital agency. We help medium and large organizations with digital strategy, user-centric design, and web platform development. We may be the only pure 99% Drupal shop in Singapore. Our team is behind some of the larger Drupal sites in Singapore, including Singtel, SMU, Today Online. I started coding as a hobby when I was 12, actually. And I started with Logo. How many of you heard of Logo? It's like the triangle, turtle, then you need to draw shapes. No? Okay. I am that old. Okay, then I move on to BASIC, and can't remember when, but I built my own mastermind game using BASIC, actually. You all know this guessing the color game, right? It's a mastermind. And I'm a lucky husband. I started Drupal with starting from Drupal 5. Lucky husband with and a proud dad of 2. And I'm active in the Singapore Drupal and Agile community. Now, before we go on, right, let me just go through the agenda first. We'll go through the Drupal way, the building blocks, architectural kata, walkthrough, and summary. Now, before we carry on, right, can I just get a show of hand first? How many of you use Drupal before? One, two, three, four. Drupal. Four, five, okay. So five. The rest, never heard of. Have you heard of Drupal? Okay, yes, but haven't used before. Okay, all right. I believe every one of you are programmers, writing code? Yes? Who doesn't write code? Everyone write code, okay. Less than 2 years experience? Naren, come on, not ten of you. 2 to 5 years? More than 5 years? Okay, good. Right. Cool. Those that those who use Drupal, right? Do you use it every day or just try it out and or one of the geek you use it and give up? You hate it, yes. You know what? When I first touched Drupal 5 in 2008, I went to the permission page and I straight away gave up. And I never touched it again until 2011. Okay, all right, good. So I hope today's session will just take out those phobia. And yeah, let's see. Right. Okay, so first, the Drupal way. Is there actually only one way to build Drupal sites? Now, introduction first. What is Drupal? It started first as a CMS, content management system, and it has since developed into a content management framework. Okay, my content management framework, what does it mean? It means that you can, it is a framework to create content management system, right? I would say that it is probably the only truly open source with thousands of modules. You see WordPress, Joomla, Magento, they have modules, they are open source, they have modules, they are, and they have paid modules. In Drupal, there's no such thing as paid modules. There are paid services linked to the modules, but there is no paid module at all. Okay, so all the modules are free. It is enterprise grade. I can't recall, if I'm not wrong, the top three CMSs in the world, Drupal, WordPress, and Joomla, only Drupal is enterprise grade, if I'm not wrong, but do check it out yourself as well. It offers various installation profiles. If you are familiar with Linux, Linux has different distribution, right? SUSE, what is that? Shit, I can't recall. Ubuntu, and so on and so forth, Red Hat, right? So in Drupal, there is such thing as well as what we call distribution. It is highly customizable and scalable. So for those who have not seen Drupal website before, I'll just go through, flash through quickly what are the Drupal websites in Singapore and in probably in Asia, or some of them that I flash out are actually international website. Okay, so Drupal can be used to create a new site. Search times is on Drupal, right? And there is installation profile to create a publication, online publication website. It's called Open Publish. In Drupal 8, there is another distribution called Thunder. It is used to create Olympic site for this NBC, if I'm not wrong. So NBC Olympic site is on Drupal. It's used to create university site. So the university in Singapore who use Drupal is SMU. It can be used to create e-commerce site as well. So you don't need to install Magento. You can actually install Drupal Commerce and Drupal, right, to capitalize on the power of the CMS. Okay. Bellabox is an Australian startup who sell subscription-based beauty products. It can be used to create open data portal as well. This is another installation profile called DCAM. And you can also create a social networking site. And there are so many other websites that you can, or application you can create using Drupal, right? Now, when I talk about Drupal developer, I'm not really playing with semantics, differentiating between developer, coder, programmer, right? It's really people who actually write code, right? And in Drupal lingo, there is another role that is called a site builder. Okay. Now, site builder can build Drupal site without actually writing any single line of code at all. Drupal developer can also build Drupal site by writing codes, right? So there are multiple ways to actually achieve the same thing. Now, what I would expect is that for Drupal developer to know how to build site and site builder, but it's not necessary for site builder to know how to build site by coding, okay? And this is what I encounter a lot of times, locally as well as globally. It's not only shared by me, but shared by leading Drupal speakers around the world as well. Usually PHP developer, I'm not necessarily a good Drupal developer. Okay. I'll go through why, the reason, but it has something to do with understanding what we call the Drupal way, right? Now, would you like to share, or would you like to just spend 1 minute talk to the person next to you and just brainstorm what do you think the Drupal way is? If you heard of it before, or you can always Google it as well. You have laptop. Developer need to be resourceful, right? Okay, 1 minute. You can discuss.
No.
introduction means talking. Oh, you're doing research first. Okay, good. Okay, 30 seconds. Seconds. Okay, time's up. Who wants to share? What do you think is a Drupal way? Anyone?
Flexibility.
Flexibility. Okay. Who else?
Complexity.
Complexity? What do you mean by complexity? Drupal way is complex, okay. Yeah. I want let me show you that. I don't know if you saw that that comics on Drupal development path when you're talking about complex, right? Okay, anyone else? While I search for the comic, anyone else? Flexibility, complexity, what else?
Extensibility.
Sorry?
Extensibility.
Extensibility, okay?
Localizable.
So this is what they say. It's not really very clear, right? But they say that the learning curve, this is the skills and knowledge, and this is the time axis. So for, I think they can put whatever it is, mod act, WordPress, Joomla, it's like this, right? So Drupal is going up and back, but then it's flat all the way. Right. Okay, so we have flexibility, complexity, extensibility, what else?
Localizable.
Anyone else?
Interoperability.
Interoperability. Okay, such a big word, yes. What does it mean, actually? All right, okay. So, to me, thinking about the Drupal way developer context, right? It is probably counterintuitive, but it really comes to this. Okay, it really comes to this. It sounds counterintuitive, but it is something that is shared by top Drupal developers around the world. Why? Okay, because the Drupal way also say that don't reinvent the wheel. Use the contrib modules, use the core module, use the contrib module. Okay, use contrib modules and contribute back. If you see that the contrib module doesn't have the feature that you have or you want, right, and you feel that it is a similar feature or it can benefit the whole community, write that extra feature, submit a patch in Drupal.org, and then contribute back to the community. We need to minimize non-scalable, non-secure custom module. Right? It's very easy. Drupal is very powerful. It makes it very easy if you know a little bit about it. Then you can just write like 3,000 lines of codes. In the previous engagement that we have, the previous developer wrote about, I think, 3,000 or 4,000 lines of codes. It was buggy. Then we rewrote it and we use contrib modules and we only use about 300 lines of a custom module, right? And it appears to be more secure and more scalable and more performant as well. Now, we need to do all this, like using more contrib, minimize the custom module, but we also need to balance the need for installing just the right amount of contrib modules. Okay. And Drupal way also mean that you need to clearly separate between logic versus theme. I first knew about open source by programming OS Commerce. Who heard of OS Commerce before? Yeah. So it's not really an MVC. A lot of business logic is in the presentation in the view layer. So I can just put print HTML tag, whatever it is, it appear. Right. When I first touched Drupal, I opened one module, I put print some HTML tag. I was wondering where is that HTML tag? It doesn't appear at all. Right. And well, that's because there is really very clear separation of the controller versus the view. Right. And sadly, across the projects that we took over, we always see there is a form of business logic in the presentation, in the view layer, which is making it like, yeah, not really scalable. You change the theming, then the logic, the business logic goes with it. So the Drupal way also mean that we need to use the counterintuitive way for programmer, counterintuitive, of configuring modules and using configuration management rather than coding. What is this configuration management actually? It's a matter of exporting the database values to file so that you can actually use it in the other environment. So you export from your local machine, which you can treat as the development server, to file, commit, push, then you pull it in your staging server, and then what you do is you just deploy that configuration. Yeah, so if it pass the user test, then you just again deploy it to the production, and you do the same thing. You deploy that configuration, and yeah, the Drupal way also means that we need to build for security, scalability, maintainability, and performance. More often than not, when we write a custom module, there is always one or two factors that we don't satisfy here. Yeah. So to close this section, there are many ways actually to build Drupal site, but there are this is pretty much opinionated, but I would say that there are few right way of building Drupal site actually. So these are some of the links that you can try to open up and read later on, right? The first one is my presentation in the Drupal Camp Manila a few months back. The rest are all the top Drupal developers around the world who actually provide their view of what it is about what it means. What Drupal Way really means to them. Okay. Any question on Drupal Way? No? Okay, cool. All right, building blocks. So if you don't need to code, then we should learn about Drupal building blocks first. What are available out of the box? All right. Look, Ma, no coding. Now, in core, there are these modules, node taxonomy block. These are really content-related modules and content structures. And you can create multiple types of content through what we call bundles. Okay. So to give an example, you can have an article content type. You can have a basic page content type. That's really that's the default that comes out of the box, right? But you can extend it. You can create a custom room booking content type, event content type, registration content type, for example, right? And for each of these content type, you can actually configure the display, how it looks like, the layout. What fields are being displayed, right? Through what we call the view mode. And in Drupal 8, there is actually one more extension here is that you can configure the form, even the form, using what we call the form mode. Now, coupled with field and entity reference, they are the strength of Drupal. In Drupal, there is this thing called entity, So node taxonomy block, these are all entity. And there are fieldable entity and there are non-fieldable entity. Let's just take node for example. Node is fieldable entity. So if we are talking about event content type, event node, the different fields are the title of the event, the speaker, the time, the venue, right? Now speaker itself, it can be a form of entity reference actually to either a user profile or to a speaker content type. Speaker content type can have name, what do you call it, the experience, for example, gender, and so on and so forth, right? Okay. So these are really the modules that define the content structure of a Drupal site, right? There are many types of field, Boolean, comments, date, email, date, time, file, image, link, list, telephone, text, entity reference, and there's combination of these, like for example, list of text, list of a number, integer, float, right. And out of the box, node and block content is revision control. What does it mean? It means that every time you save a new value to the field, it will save it as a new revision. Okay. So block revision is new in Drupal 8. It was not available in Drupal 7. Block field is also new in Drupal 8. Block type is also new in Drupal 8. Right. So block and node now are very, very similar. The difference is that block doesn't have a user ID to it, whereas node still have a user ID, so you know who is the one who actually create the content, the author of the content. Okay, node itself has lots of built-in features which also make it very heavy entity, right? Now by mentioning this, normally for simple application we can extend the use of node to create, like what I say, room booking, for example, or a payment type, and so on and so forth, right? And it comes at a cost, because, like I said, node is has a revision control, node is fieldable, and so on and so forth, right? So it makes the object itself, the class itself, to be very heavy. If you create an application that is focusing on performance, for example, you may want to create, to write your own, to build your own entity rather than using node. Now, just to share common pitfalls that I see when vendors are actually using Drupal for these three modules. But bear in mind that this is very generalized pitfalls and sometimes opinionated as well, right? So, what I mean by that is that it really depends on case by case basis in the end, right? But in general, these are the pitfalls. People use nodes for landing pages. This is actually debatable. For us, we don't really use nodes for landing pages, because landing pages are supposed to be a structure. Unless we are really sure that all the pages in the website are actually really just basic pages, for example, or just content, right? But if you are talking about event website, right? So the landing page will be a list of different events. It's not supposed to be a node. It's not supposed to be a content. Okay. And the second pitfall that I noticed is that use multiple taxonomy vocabularies for single category. Now, taxonomy is really a way to categorize the content. So it can be, the simplest form of taxonomy is actually just tagging, keyword tagging. It can be a type of event, right? So a type of event can be paid or free. So when the developer is actually using two different taxonomy to categorize the same event, well, it works if the category are totally different, but there are times that I see that the category are actually exactly the same, but the developer is using two different vocabularies. make it very, very difficult to categorize later on. Okay. At this moment, probably let me just pull up first, show you a demo, quick demo, how a node looks like. If you have Drupal 8 installed already, it should look something like this. This is a fresh Drupal 8.1.8, it's really still empty, right? So go to home. Okay, so this is actually a node. Okay, and this is actually a block. And if we edit the node, let me see. Sorry, this one is actually not a node. Sorry, my mistake. That's just an empty. That's just a title. Okay. So this is the title, the field, which is the body field, the tag, which actually refer to the taxonomy term itself. So I can put the tag as PHP conference talk. Okay. You can upload image if you want to. Save and publish. There you go. We created the first node. Okay. Let me turn off that debugging first. You'll have time to try this out later if I can rush through my materials. Okay. Now you can see here that so this is a block. This is actually a node. But when we go to the home page, which is the landing page, by right it should show a list of nodes. True enough, we have the first node here. Right. We can create the second node by going through the same effort. Let me just press back and submit the form the second time so that I have the second node very quickly. Go back to the home page and that's it. You have two different nodes here. Okay? Right. So the nodes have the taxonomy term linking to it through entity reference or term reference. And there is a block here, search block, tool block. We want to add another block here, let's say information session, some information, for example. I'll just go through here this quickly for now, but later we can go through it slowly. Add custom block. Okay, I have created this ABC. Let me just edit it first. To blocks, info. Okay, not going up. Okay. Interestingly, it doesn't appear here. This is what I talked about earlier. There is a create new revision here. Right, this is a bit weird though that it doesn't appear. It should actually appear here. Sidebar first featured place block. Ah, okay. Need to press okay, so there is place block here. Feature top breadcrumb content sidebar first place block. info, paste block. Save block. Alright, let's go back. There you go. So the block actually appears here. Okay. That's a very easy and quick way to actually build a site. But it really depends on whether or not this is how you want to build it. Because like I said, although this is a revision control, but it's not really, it doesn't have any user information, user ID information in it, right? So yes, you can do it this way, but is it, will it be maintainable, scalable? We don't know. Really depends on the application. Okay. Any question on the node block and taxonomy? Everyone is clear? Or you lost me already? Okay. Okay. Good. Okay, next one. User module, which is available in core as well. It is an entity well for users of the site, right? So when you create user in Drupal, you allow them to actually log in to the website and do special things that only authenticated user can do. It is fieldable, but there is no revision. It works with locale and region for language and time zone. So there is this module in Drupal called locale and region. You can turn on the language, the translation, as well as the time zone. So you can have people choose their own language if you want to, and choose where they actually live. So the time that is shown on the website will be reflected their time zone. It's role-based, and with each role comes a granular permission, which is another strength of Drupal. So just now I say that when I first touched Drupal, I was actually getting scared of the permission page. The permission page in Drupal is really very granular. It can be daunting for people who first see it, right? So this is the permission page. Okay, but no need to be like scared, or no need to like feel overwhelmed, because what you need to know is really just take it slowly. Like for example, let's talk about node. We talk about node already. So you see the permission is that, take the simple one, view published content. We allow anonymous user to actually view published content, right? We allow authenticated user also to view published content. But when we talk about create new content for article, actually these two checkboxes are not ticked. Only admin can actually create this. And read the next line, delete any content of article, is also not ticked, it's only admin. So it's pretty much simple, I would say. It's just that the quantity is overwhelming for someone who first time see this. Yeah. Not to mention that, remember I say that you can actually add roles. So there are some sites that you can have like 10 roles in a site, which is not so good actually, right? But that means that you have 10 multiplied by how many roles in terms of permission, you get that many permission. Okay, and user login actually is not optimized for performance, but in Drupal 8, this issue potentially solved by the big pipe technology, which is used in Facebook, right? So big pipe means that the caching is really very granular. It can cache a specific block only. So when the page loads, content that are cache longer, for example, it will just load first based on the browser cache, and then content that need to be refreshed all the time, it'll load the last. Okay, it reduces the server load as well. And again, just to share a common pitfall, again, is generalized and opinionated, right? I've seen sites that have too many roles, too many access control modules. Access control modules allow you to extend the well, the access control of different roles. For example, you can allow a user to create a group, and only content created within this group, people is accessible by member of that group, and that module is called organic group. Then there are other modules as well, which are called content access. So that provides more granularity in terms of the node access itself. Instead of having the access to all of the same content type, let's say an article, all the article content types in the site, you can specifically just select one particular node and open up the access to a particular user, for example. And the last one is client requirements to tweak user features. For example, email as username, non-unique email. In Drupal, by default, user is created by unique username and unique email address. But there are so many requirements from client coming saying that, hey, can you just use email address for the username, for example, or my system actually have a non-unique username, so yeah. So that really the pitfalls, I would say, of extending the Drupal user module. Okay, any question on user? No? Okay, next, translation. Translation is available out of the box as well. In Drupal 8, it's much, much more simplified. There are only four modules: language, content translation, interface translation, configuration translation. I'll not go into the detail, right? It actually follow what we call the entity and translation approach, very configurable. It means that it goes all the way to the granular level of the field. You can define whether a certain field need to be translated or not. Okay, in Drupal 7, when we are talking about content translation, is the whole node. In Drupal 8, or actually there is a module in Drupal 7 called entity translation, so that's the one that treat individual entity to be translatable. Okay. Right, the next module that's very, very powerful used to be a contrib module in Drupal 6 and 7 and become part of core now is views. Okay, views module allow us to create database query in point and click configuration rather than writing the SQL query. It should be used to power any of a list of tables, like what you saw earlier. When I go to the home page, it displays two different nodes, right? That is actually powered by views, right? So this is the interface, quick preview how views actually look like. It's pretty much the same like SQL query, right? That you select what field you select. It's all here. Where the condition is actually here, the filter criteria. Okay. Now the good thing about views is that it extend the functionality more towards like you can create the whole page just based on this view display, right? In that case, then the display type is actually a page display type. You can create a block display type as well, and you use it as a block. You can create what we call the view pane display type and use it as a panel. Okay. And the one that I didn't open up here in the advance allow you to accept arguments. So you can actually have one view for a list of different events. For example, the site will be example.com/events/free. Free can be fed into an argument for views, right? Then if you go to another page /event/paid, so paid will be passed as argument as well. So in the end, you only need to build one view display rather than creating two separate view display. Okay. So that's the common pitfall of other vendors. A lot of Drupal developers implementing views is that they have 10 different pages, 10 different lists. They create 10 different view display. It makes it very, very difficult to maintain. And it's very bad if, let's say, when they create a new view display, they call it as the display list is the same page. So you will see here, page. There's no way that you can tell just at one glance, right? That this is a particular view display that I want to edit. Okay, the rest of the core modules features I just mentioned here quickly. There's an actions, tracker, aggregator, band, book, big pipe. Big pipe I mentioned earlier about the cache, partial cache. Breakpoint, migrate content. RDF, this is for the, what's the name? Schema.org, right? So that your content can be recognized by search engine. Okay. Caching, forum, search, REST as in RESTful API. So it's available in core as well. You can just turn it on, then your Drupal website can become the so-called your database server for your app. Responsive image. Yeah. Responsive image and breakpoint work together, and you can define the responsive image for the different breakpoint. All right, so those are the core modules I mentioned. Now I go to the contributed modules. I'll not go through a lot of them. These are the ones that we use a lot of times, right? First one is Path Auto. This is to generate SEO-friendly URL. Like, for example, like I said earlier, /events/ PHP conference, for example. If we don't use Path Auto, the node will appear as the system path, example.com/node/41, right? The next set of modules, paragraphs, ctools, panels, and DS. DS is short form of display suite. We use them a lot for layouting tools. Now, this is something that we actually do differently, and what I noticed the leading Drupal shop in the world are doing differently as well, or well, actually probably not very true, but a lot of shops are actually using these modules to do the layout rather than doing the layout directly in the template file. Okay. For us, the reason why we do this is that we want to empower our client as well. If they need to change something, they don't need to like go inside the file. They need to know which TPL PHP file or which tweak file in Drupal 8 they need to change. And after that, they need to know how to do a git commit, git push, git pull. Okay, some of our clients actually don't really know all these things. So if everything is on the interface, by using all of these modules, right? If they want to add additional field, they want to display additional field, or they want to customize how that field looks like, right? They can actually do all this themselves rather than coming back to us as a developer. eForm is a module to do web form. I'm not sure whether this is really working well for Drupal 8. I have not tried it myself. In Drupal 7, there is a web form module, very powerful. Field permissions, content access, these are the modules that we use a lot of time for access control. You can set a granular permission to the field or to the content. And workbench is used for publishing workflow. Rules is used for point and click automation. When I say automation here is that when someone saves a note of an article content type, display a message, congratulations, for example. All these are really point and click. There is no need for you to write any single line of code at all. Okay. Commerce, obviously, is for e-commerce. Yeah, so those are the contrib modules that we use a lot in our projects. Now, if we exhausted all the modules already and we still cannot find what we want, then we go into creating our own custom modules, right? There are really thousands of excellent online resources on teaching you how to code Drupal custom module properly. You can, these are some of my past presentations. Okay, you can also subscribe to this newsletter, weekly drop and Drupal newsletter. They have a lot of links every week to point you to good Drupal resources. Well, yeah, actually, sometimes yeah, there are really not no right or wrong way of building a site, right? Only what works for the project and for the client. And this is also shared by Greg Dunlap. He is one of the senior architect in Lalabot. Lalabot is a leading Drupal shop in US. They're the one who built a MTV website, if I'm not wrong, and CNBC, if I'm not wrong. Yeah. So yeah, in his one of his project, he actually insisted to do it the right way, but then the budget is not enough to do it the right way. So what he did is really just the enough, acceptable to fit into the budget. But he didn't take shortcuts. That's the most important, right? Pros of writing custom modules is that it is very quick to achieve unique requirements of client. It has less dependencies, meaning that less possibility of breakage. If one of the, let's say a Drupal core is updated, but you don't write, you don't use any of the services of Drupal core, for example, then chances are your module will not break, right? But the cons is that it's not covered by Drupal security team. There is this Drupal security team, they are professional, they are paid by Drupal.org to actually find vulnerabilities in Drupal core as well as Drupal contrib modules. So if your module is not in Drupal.org, it means that they will not cover these security loopholes, right? And the other two cons are you are reinventing the wheel rather than contributing back to the community. And you also cannot depend on community for documentation and patches. Okay? So to me, there are actually more cons than pros in terms of writing our own custom module. This is something that I realized when I after I did my first gig, my first Drupal gig. What happened is my background is developer, right? So obviously I just code all the way. Then when the time comes for me to update all the modules, the core modules, the contrib modules because of security patches, that's where I get the headache. Then my custom code actually breaks or is not compatible with the new one, and so on and so forth, right? So ever since then when we build sites, especially bigger, like really big scale sites, Singtel, SMU, we seldom write, hardly write custom module. When we built the SMU site back in 2012-13, we actually didn't write any single custom module at all. Okay. Custom JavaScript, yes. No custom module at all. Yeah. But unfortunately, the SMU site that you see now, what I heard is that 90% of the code or implementation has changed already as well. Yeah. All right. Now, the last part that I want to touch here is configuration management, right? So in Drupal 7, there is a module called features. And the purpose is, like I mentioned earlier, it exports the configuration from database to file so that you can commit it in your repository, pull it in the other environment, then you just revert the configuration. In Drupal 8, there is something called configuration management module. And it solves a lot of the problem of configuration management in Drupal 7. This is my observation so far. Features in Drupal 7, not many people actually use it. Vendors here in Singapore, around the region, I think only those who are like more active, like being involved in Drupal meetup, know about this and use it, right? Other than this, I don't see much developer actually using it, which is actually quite sad. So, but that is also because features are were quite difficult to use in Drupal 7. Configuration management make it much, much easier to export configuration, which we will try later on. The issue is that it's all just dumb for you. The whole Drupal configuration, the whole Drupal site configuration just dumb to you in single folder, right? So in the end, we still go back to use features. But features in Drupal 8 is actually a much, much better already. Okay? We'll try it out later. Okay, any question on the building blocks? No? I talked too much already, so let's start with the activity, architectural kata. Time to get our hands dirty. Let's split into four groups. Let me see. How many people are there? 3, 5, 10, 15, 19. Yeah, I think it's just nice. Split into four groups, about 4 to 5 people each. Okay, go, make your group. You want to join?
Okay, this computer's for recording.
Okay,
yeah.
Yeah, but you can join the discussion if you want to. I'll just stay here. Okay, everyone has your group already? Everyone has your team? Who doesn't have team yet? Who doesn't have team yet? Okay, team one, raise your hand. Who's team one? Only 3 people. Can 2 more join? Okay, team two. Okay, how about both of you just join team one, then team two you can. As in, you can join like 5 people like that. Okay? All right. Okay, so team one here, team two, all the way to the back to the, team three here, 5 people. Team four, just nice. I think you need to join
team four. Okay, no problem. I don't have to join.
It'll be fun. Okay, everyone clear, right? On the team formation. The 3 ladies at the back.
What are you doing?
Huh? They're playing capture the flag. Okay, so we will generate and agree to work on one architectural kata. Anyone seen this before? Akatas Heroku app.com. No? Okay. I'll show you what it is later. So what you need to do during the discussion later is to do a research and discuss on the following. What should the content structure be of the platform that you're going to build? Right. Which modules are you going to use? And is there any custom modules? Why do you need the custom modules? Right. Now, in every team, can I have a show of hand as well? Who has a Drupal experience again? Drupal experience. Okay. That team is very unfair. Okay. I work with Jesse and Vanessa, so... Okay, this group, Drupal experience, you have. Okay, that group have anyone with Drupal experience? Don't have Don't have at all. Okay. Okay. I think Jesse will hate my decision. Can you move? Can you swap one team member, or you feel comfortable without any Drupal experience teammate? Sure? Okay, fine. All right. Okay. Now, what we are going to do is 15-minute discussion. Then after that, we'll have 2-minute sharing by each team. and then another 15-minute discussion, then another 2-minute sharing. Okay? Yeah. So what are we going to build then? Let's try it out. Let's see. Let's see whether this is something that's doable. So this is actually generated randomly. Okay, let's just read this one first. If it is not doable, then we can generate the other one. I have the BLT. A national sandwich shop wants to enable fax in your order, but over the internet instead, in addition to their current faxing service. User, million of users. Requirement, user will place their order, then be given a time to pick up their sandwich and directions to the shop, which must integrate with Google Maps. If the shop offers a delivery service, dispatch the driver with the sandwich to the user. Mobile device accessibility, offer national daily promotionals or specials, offer local daily promotionals or specials, accept payment online or in person or on delivery. Okay. This is actually a good platform. I feel for this group probably this is very heavy on the commerce side. You install commerce, you can have everything around. Almost everything, right? So let's try if we can get another one. I am generating this randomly, but it is more to like to have that like surprise element as well, some unknown element. But I have some backup. If let's say we cannot find the one, then we can work on. Check your work. Okay, university has greatly expanded its CS course and wants to be able to automate the grading of simple programming assignments. 300 plus students per year, plus staff and admin. The requirement, student must be able to upload their source code, which will be run and graded. Grades and runs must be persistent and auditable. There must be a plagiarism detection system involving comparing with other submissions and also submitting to a web-based service, Turnitin. There must be some level of integration with the university's LMS. How many feel that this is a doable platform? Oh, you want to try this? No? No one? Okay, let's refresh again. Let's see. If until 5, we cannot find the one that everyone is agreeable to do, right? I'll pick one. All staff, no craft. Conference organizer needs a management system for the conferences he runs. Oh, interesting. Requirements. Attendees can access speaking schedule online, including room assignments. Speakers can manage talks, enter, edit, modify. Attendees vote up, down talks. Organizer can notify attendees of schedule changes up to the minute if attendees opt in. Each conference, being a different subject, can be branded independently. Speaker slides are accessible online only to attendees. Evaluation system via webpage, email, SMS, or phone. Users, hundreds of speakers, dozens of event staff, thousands of attendees. I think this is very doable and it's very, very relevant to today's, to the session. Shall we do this? Okay. All right. Okay. I see some people nodding. That's approval. Okay. So again, to recap, right, I'll leave this here. But to recap, what you need to do is that to have 15-minute discussion, discuss on what kind of content structure you are going to have, right? What kind of modules to use? You have your laptop to do a search. If you have Drupal site on your website on your laptop already, it'll be good, right? You can try it out straight away. If not, then or you can rely on people who have done Drupal before. And is there any custom module that you need? Right. Just try it out first. Then we will after you discuss. And let people share. You can learn from the other group sharing. Then you can discuss again, see if your strategy actually changed. Then you can discuss again. And then we will go through the walkthrough of how are we going to build this website using Drupal. Okay, the Drupal way. Okay, 15 minutes starts now.
Thank you.
No, you can switch off first. Yeah.
Please listen. Yes.
Use of modules.
So you discuss about the modules. Yeah. All right. Okay. What are the modules?
User module has like types.
Oh, user. Okay. Then.
User has a types, different types.
Okay.
One is a speaker, organizer.
Speaker.
Organizer.
Organizer.
Attendees,
okay.
Then next module is talks.
Talks. Mm-hmm.
Then room assignment.
Room assignment.
Votes and data.
Sorry?
Votes.
Vote. Oh, vote. Okay, so vote is another type. Module or? So you're talking about user module earlier. Then top, is it module or is it part of node?
Node.
Okay, so this is node, alright. Room assignment?
Also
node. Vote?
Module.
Module, okay. Alright. So. Okay, let me just erase this, okay. So, both module. Okay, what else?
This is one feedback, this module.
Feedback, module.
Yeah.
Okay, can discuss this later.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Then?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Anything else that you discuss? Alright, so content structure, modules to use. Custom module?
No.
No custom module at all. Okay. Alright, team two. What did you discuss?
Scheduling module. I'm not sure whether there's any.
Oh, you didn't search?
We just discussed.
Calendar.
It's calendar.
Yeah.
Is calendar in Drupal 8 or anything? I can't remember. Okay.
Yes.
Is
this C top calendar module?
Oh, morning.
Calendar, is it? Is that Drupal 8? Yeah. How to check is you search, right? Drupal calendar. Then you go into drupal.org/project/calendar. When you scroll all the way to the bottom, you'll see the releases. If you see anything like 8.something. Date is in power already in a way.
Actively being ported.
Calendar.
Huh?
There is.
Actively being ported.
Okay, actively being ported. So, okay. Next.
Evaluation.
Evaluation. What is this? Is this a module or?
Just think of the functions.
Okay.
I think we identify the function first. Then we try to search for the module.
Good. Okay.
And then the material type like slides and stuff. Slides and documentation or what?
Slides. Okay. Presentation. What is this? Also, just a group or function.
Material.
No, as in. Can we relate this back to the building blocks that we discussed earlier?
Right. Yeah,
have you thought about
custom
this?
Custom content, maybe.
Custom content.
Establishment under custom content.
Okay. So this content is loads, right? Okay.
Don't need to put
anything. Next. Anything else?
So it just like the node has its own custom content. Then
yeah.
The custom content, let's say you have the name, the title, the description, the slide, presentation.
Yeah, so slide presentation is another content type.
Yeah.
That's what you're saying. Okay, sure. Then, any other things?
The voting or everything? Is it said already?
No. Voting?
There's a module for that.
Yes. That's a trademark, you know. There's a module for that. It builds you.
those who haven't heard before, there's a module for that, it's trademark control. Okay, anyway, anything else? Yeah, sure. This is your site. This is their site.
Okay. Then the user content type.
Okay, user.
Three different users.
Okay, what are those?
And speaker, organizer, and attendee.
Speaker, organizer, and attendee. Okay. And, anything else?
Talk.
Is this a content type?
Yes.
Okay.
Link to all others.
All right. Anything else?
Room. Content type.
Okay. Anything else?
That's all?
Okay. Cool. All right. Team 3. What do you come up with? Yes. Okay, user. Okay. Speaker. Organizer, right? Attendees. Okay. Next.
The organizer can notify
notify schedule changes. Okay.
Brand
their conference. The rest. You can also listen and borrow ideas from other groups, yeah?
Speaker
can manage talk and assignment.
Assignment
rooms. Is the speaker. Manages as in edit talks, right? Edit talks, okay. Then, sign run room. And set room, okay, next.
Attendees.
Opt-in. Notification. Okay. Next.
Speaker. Speaking schedules, yeah.
Huh?
Can access the speaker.
Oh, can access, okay. Can access schedule, okay. So this is attendance, right?
Yeah.
Attendance can access slides, okay. Anything else? Attendance can feedback. Okay. Anything else? Sorry? Feedback. Okay. Up number. Okay. Anything else?
C6A
is Drupal 6. CCK is field in 7. Is that all?
Yeah.
Sorry? Feedback can be contact module. Okay. All right. Anything else? No? That's all? Okay. Team 4.
That's basically someone missing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Is your discussion?
Yeah.
Get your requirements. What's the outcome of the discussion? Okay, talk is content type. Then? Room, taxonomy. Okay.
So in the
talk,
we have
the user. Okay. Mm-hmm.
And we have
the user. Okay. Speaker, organizer, and attendees. Okay. Rules. So rules is a concrete module in Drupal. Yes, then.
So the user can
update the talk and can send an email to all the notification for speaker change. Oh, okay. Send to the police.
Also notification
to send email to attendees
when speaker upload the slide.
Speaker looks like.
And the slide is a field.
Lisa? Field.
It's a
how to bring. Okay, so it'll be a slide. It's just a field. Okay. Alright. Anything else? Okay, good. Alright. So that's very good. So the first one, the first team focuses a lot on the user. Okay, so this is really the content structure. Here focus more team two focus more on the function, right? Team three actually, it's not really function either, right? Yes, there are some function, some user content type as well. Team 3 actually comes out interesting with the user stories, right? So, which is good to come up with the support to translate the requirement to small chunks to that is that we can take action. Then team 4. Come up with the exact which module to use and which content type to use and so on and so forth, right? Okay, so I'll leave you to discuss again for, let me see, what time is it now? another 15 minutes and you can improve on the idea based on what you hear from the other team, or you can always build on top of what you have discussed just now, which were not really complete, right? At the end of the discussion, you really need to know the content structure, which one going to be node, which one taxonomy, which one user, which modules to use, and if there is any custom module. Oh, by the way, Team 2, 3, 4, did I ask, do you identify any custom module? No? No? Okay, good. All right. 15 minutes.
There is a module, isn't it? Call event calendar, portable in.
Okay.
Then date reminder.
Okay.
Actually, we found the module event calendar.
Okay.
So this one is before we found. So this is a module for the schedule.
Okay, alright.
Yeah. And then the boards is we found the module, right? Rate.
Great. Okay. Great module. Okay. Cool. Anything else?
The user module already there.
Okay. So the team found rate module and the event calendar module.
For notification and the
rate module.
Okay, notification for, okay, using the rate then. Yeah, good. Team 2? Any update? Any update to...
Any update?
I don't know how to search it.
Don't know how to search?
Any modules or... Just by looking at the description, it's so hard to...
Okay, good. That's a good observation.
Unless
you
need to download and then install, and then you see
what fields or what function they can provide. Okay, that's valid. Okay, so there is no more improvement to this. Okay, team 3. Any updates? Okay.
So for brand conference, you use
XinMSN. For the brand. This one, the conference, you use taxonomy, okay.
Notify
schedule changes action, okay.
Manage
talk, okay, quick edit, yep.
Then activity tracker for the opting in for notification.
Okay, so another tracker, okay. Then
options for voting out right now.
Options?
Yeah.
Options for. Okay, so options field, using options field.
Yeah.
Okay, so alright. Next.
Then for evaluation system, we're not sure if the evaluation public or private.
Mm-hmm.
If it's public, then we use comment. If it's private, then we use content.
Okay.
Then last one, assess meeting schedule.
You're using Blender, right? Can we use custom one?
Which one?
The assess meeting schedule.
Access the schedule.
Yeah. Okay.
So this one can then. Calendar not for Drupal 8.
Custom module.
All right. You say event calendar. You found event calendar. Okay. Team 4.
Implementation of the e-form.
Which one?
Implementation of
e-form. E-form for which one?
Maybe the event calendar plus collecting feedback.
Collecting feedback. Okay. Feedback.
Starting only.
That is the package.
Okay. Anything else?
Can I even send the details about the video?
Okay. Feedback using e-form. Any more? No more? Okay, good. How do you find the discussion? Do you have any questions? So I know there is one question. So the thing is, we have limited time, right? So let's see, I'll just cover the questions first. Because that is probably more important. So the question coming from group 2 is, how do we know which module to use, right? Yeah, the description is probably is very it's not very clear either. I personally actually like group 3's approach, because all of the modules mentioned there other than calendar are all core modules, right, which is possible to be done that way. So feedback, up, down, up, or down vote, that one was not really covered. But in terms of feedback using comment, to me that works too, right? So this is a very real situation case in real life. When client actually asks for a specific feature, then there is no contrib module. So what do? Do you tell them that, okay, we will just do it? Or you tell them that, okay, if we just want to use a contrib module in Drupal, then you may not have exactly the same functionality, but you have this functionality, right? It can be a workaround. It can fit into 80% of their need, which is probably better rather than creating a custom module. So if just now you say voting, which voting module then?
Rate module.
I was looking for 5-star. 5-star is very popular last time, but okay. So rate is not available for Drupal 8. Currently being ported, okay. Yeah. So maybe it's there already. If it's there, then maybe we can find it. My cursor disappears. So I'd like to. There aren't any resources for module rate. Is the name rate? It is rate. Yeah, rate. Okay. So I'd like to show you this tool as well, which if you were in Benmark's presentation earlier, you saw that there is a tool to help to make developers' life easier, right? So this is the command line tool built on top of a composer. It's meant for Drupal 8 only. It's called Drupal Console. All the while, the Drupal shell, which we call drush, has been around since Drupal 6, Drupal 7, and also available for Drupal 8. But there is this guy called Enzo. He actually visited us beginning of the year. He's from Costa Rica, and he has been creating this Drupal console project. And well, there are a lot of interesting things that you can do with Drupal console, which I hope I can share with you later. Okay, but you can use either Drupal console or you can use drush to check, like for example, the version drush rl rate. Okay, and then we see that there are all these versions. You can actually download these versions directly on the command line, rather than you go to the website, then you download it, put it in the folder, enable it in the Drupal interface, and so on and so forth. Right. Okay. So rate we can't really use. So how do we select? There are a few things. First is to read the description. Description not clear enough. The only way is to, or there is another way, is to take a look at the screenshot. Sometimes the screenshot is very clear. If the screenshot is not clear enough, the only way is really to just download the module, enable it on your so-called your sandbox, your local sandbox site, and see whether it works or not. Whether does it fit to your requirement or not, right? So that's the only way to assess. Another thing that you need to see is that when you are browsing the project page, right, take a look at this reported installs. If you have like
anything beyond 5,000, that's very good already. It means really there are a lot of people downloading this and using this, right? And then take a look at the version number as well. Is it a stable release? Then is it covered by the Drupal security team? Then if there is only the dev version, then it means that it's not stable release. Sometimes it works. Well, we have some dev only version module, right, on production site as well. Then the other thing to see is, this, the activity as well as the bug report. How many issues are there in total, open? How many of those issues are actually bugs, soft bugs, right? So this will help you determine whether or not should you actually use this module. If really a lot of like 142 open, then we can just click it and see what are the comments there, right? You can see user can still vote on their own comments. And that doesn't sound too nice, right? Okay. So you can read through quickly. Then what you can do is, well, search for another module then if it doesn't fit your purpose. So that's how we normally select modules. And of course it comes with experience as well. When I say that, oh, in the past I used 5 stars. So that's really the, I know that this is a so-called module that can give feedback, very nice. But unfortunately, again, no Drupal 8 version. So this is a challenge with Drupal 8. It was released last November. From our observation, normally Drupal major release stabilize pretty quickly in terms of the core module, but the contrib module will only be ported to the new version about 1 to 1.5 years after the major version is released. So this means that probably by this November or by quarter one next year, only then we have more contrib modules in Drupal 8. Yeah. So that makes us to be very selective as well on which project that we want to do with Drupal 8. If it is simple site like this one, what we is actually considered a simple site, we can actually do it in Drupal 8 with some compromises. But what's the advantage? The client shelf life for the website shelf life is probably like another 7 years, I don't know, 5 to 7 years, right? Drupal 7 was released in 2011, and I don't think it will reach end of life in another 2 or 3 years time. So there's about 7 to 8 years there. Okay? And what they say is Drupal 7 will become LTS long-term support until Drupal 9 is released, or until Drupal 9 reach long-term support, something like that. Yeah. So yeah, Drupal 7 still have some knowledge, but if you can do Drupal 8 now, it'll be good as well. Yeah. So yeah, that's about the module selection. Any other question? Anyone has any other question on how to choose or how to decide how to build, how to architect the site? No? No? I think pretty much all the four teams come up with a similar approach, right? And the very distinctive one is the user. Everyone come up with there should be the three user roles, right? Then that means that you will need to configure the permission based on these three user roles, right? Okay, so now we have half an hour only. If you end earlier, you can actually go to PHP meetup earlier and eat faster over there. Okay. Or you can use the time all the way until 7 o'clock. And you also have you have a choice here. Do you want to go through the demo of building the Drupal site, what we discussed just now, right? Or do you want me to go through the some of the tools, like for example Drush and the Drupal console? That one is really meant for, or more meant for developer. actually. Your choice. So just give, just have a show of hand who wants to build the site, continue to build the site. Build the site. Nobody?
Is it a demo?
Is really go through what we discussed just now,
so
right? And to configure.
Time, right?
Sorry.
So you'll be building the site for us to see.
Yes. Yeah. How do we actually go about it? And in the end, I will export it using the features configuration management, right? So that's the first part. The second part is I'll just touch on drush, using drush, using Drupal console. Right. It's probably, this will be shorter, I think. We can end much faster. So, demo on the so-called site building. Site building, who choose for site building? Site building, okay. Drush, Drupal console, also. Learn everything. Okay, private session, Larry. Anyway, I need to meet you. Okay, so all right, so let's do the site building then. Okay, who has the Drupal 8 on your laptop already? Okay, we have some. Okay, those who don't have yet, right? Just share, just bunch up together to see. Yeah. Okay, so that's the part on the walkthrough. Then after that, I'll close with the summary, and that's it. Okay. Right. Maybe I should just. Alright. Okay, so we were talking about user, right? Just now. Everyone get the Drupal 8, or as in those people who get the Drupal 8 site already. You can log in as admin. You see this page. Has the other two tracks, have the other two tracks finished? Yes? Yeah, so. Okay. Huh? What? Okay, sure. Okay, so we go to roles here. Under people, roles, you can actually add more role, right? Normally we don't add, for if it is the least privileged user, in this case, attendees, we don't create additional role. We just reuse the authenticated user. Because no matter what attendees, I would say that attendees should be able to log into the website. Or if the attendees are not supposed to log into the website, then you can actually use the anonymous user role. But they should be able to like subscribe to the notification and so on and so forth, right? So chances are you will want to have the authenticated user role there, yeah? Okay, so I would just add two more, which is the organizer and speaker. So speaker first. Speaker, and role, organizer. Okay, cool. We have five now, right? And now different user may have different fields, but I think in this particular use case there is no such requirement, right? Do we need to have different fields for different user? No, right? Okay. Now, so how about, okay, so we talk about the user, then we can try to create the taxonomy now. Taxonomy falls under structure. Taxonomy. Now we can add the vocabulary. What are some of the idea for the taxonomy vocabulary just now? Someone say it's a room, then the branding, the talk itself, right? The conference, right? Branding is equal conference, right?
Talking.
Talk. Okay. What does it say? Okay, I lose it. Yeah, I really lose it. Architectural kata. Okay, never mind. So, okay, so we can just say it's a brands of the top. And then we can add term just to populate that first. PHP conference Asia 2016, for example. Then we have a Ruby, red dot Ruby 2016. We have Drupal Camp Singapore 2016. Okay. Now at this time, probably I will just realize that we should have another field here. We already have the description there. We have the name. How about the picture? So we can actually create a manage field for this particular brand's vocabulary. Then we can add field, which is an image field. Label image. So in the field setting, you can set different things, like for example, what's the maximum resolution, what's the minimum resolution, enable the title or the alt tags, right? Then you can also set the field setting to be how many values do you allow people to upload, right? And then the other thing that we can set is also to set the path default. Where is that file directory? Date custom, right? What we can do here, although I'm not very sure in Drupal 8 yet, is there is a way to put in the this is what we call token in Drupal, right? So the format will look something like this: taxonomy term name. Okay, but I'm not exactly sure how the format is like, right? So it will just create this file directory here in the files folder of Drupal. Okay. I just leave everything to be the default. Now, if I go back to the brands, so we are talking about the brands vocabulary with these terms. Okay, then we can upload the picture for PHP Conference Asia 2016. Choose image. PHP Save it. Okay. Alt text is required. Okay, and that's it, right? So when you click on the particular taxonomy term, you can actually see the image here. but you can also hide the image if you want to. Now the thing is, this particular taxonomy term is not tagged to any talk yet. So let's, how about we create the talk now? Okay, so talk, I think everyone agree that talk is actually a content type, right? So we'll create a new content type under structure, content types, add new content type, talk. Title, review, yeah, I just leave everything to be default. Okay. Now the default field is the body field. We can add more field. What is it? What are the field? The brands, right? Taxonomy term. Label. Brands. Brand. Singular. Referencing to taxonomy term, and then we can actually limit that the taxonomy term that we want to reference is only for brands vocabulary, and we can set it to be required field. Okay. So what else? What are the field under talk or content type that we can think of? Session, right? The time, right?
Speaker
is okay, good. Speaker, yeah, we can actually say, you can actually do that. So it will be a user reference speaker. Only one is also required. Save. And then we should have the date. Time. Date and time. Okay. Default date required field. Save. Alright, so we have these four fields. I think it's enough for our purpose for the demo. So let's create some talk then. Yeah? But before we create talk, we should probably create speakers first, because there is a reference to speaker, right? So we add a new user now. So how do we add new user? Go to people, add user. Okay. Okay, speaker one at mailinator.com. Username speaker 1, password 123123, active, and he is actually a speaker. Okay, the rest leave it default. We have a speaker 2, mailinator.com, speaker 2, 123123, speaker. Okay, all right, so we have two speakers already. Now let's populate the talk then. So we create a new content, the talk content type. And, well, Drupal site building for developer. Okay, the brand is PHP. Conference Asia. It's autocomplete. Speaker is speaker 1. Okay. Then the date will be, today's date is 22 August 16, 4 o'clock. Okay. Save and publish. Let's create just another one, Magento module development, speaker 2, okay, alright, so we actually have two talk already here, And if we go back to the taxonomy terms earlier, structure, taxonomy, go under brands, list terms. Now if I click on the PHP Conference Asia, by right, it should show the two nodes which are actually tagged by the this particular taxonomy term, right? So this is the default behavior of Drupal. We can actually customize this if we want to, right? So how do we customize this? Okay, let's try to create a okay, the easiest way to customize this is, let's say I want to move the image down, or I want to hide this image label here, right? That's where the view mode, when I mentioned earlier, view mode actually comes into picture. So in almost every entity in Drupal, there is the bundle, in every bundle in Drupal, right? One vocabulary, this is actually a bundle. Content type is also a bundle. You can manage the display. And here, clicking on the manage display, we can actually just, we hide the, like for example, image label, hidden. Okay. Description, we can show it if you want to. There's no description actually, right? Then another thing that we can do is, we can actually format the image style. So we can auto-resize the image. It can be bigger or smaller. Let's make it into a thumbnail. Save it. Let's go back to the PHP conference Asia. There you go. So you have the thumbnail there. So far we have done all this configuration without writing any single line of code at all. Okay. So in the interest of time, what I'll do next is to show you the configuration management. How do we actually export all these features out so that we can deploy to production, to the staging or the production server, right? I have installed the features module here. So what I need to do is, okay, before that, maybe I'll show you my Git first so that you can see. Let me just stage everything so that we can just see the difference later on. Okay, not necessary that we stage all those. Okay, so let's say that we want to export what we call the features. Okay, so under configuration features, we can create the new features. So what do we name this feature? It can be a let's say we call it an event management module. Okay, event management module. So what you're doing here is actually creating a custom module, but again, you're not writing any single line of code at all. You let feature module to export all these settings, right? So you can put in the version there. Best practice, you should actually put in the description as well, right? So what do I want to export? I want to export the top content type. And we'll automatically select the different fields that we populated just now in the top content type, right? It also export the view display that we created just now, right? But this is more on the node, which is the top itself, right? So what else do we need to export? The brands, taxonomy vocabulary, and chances are the fields will be exported there as well. Taxonomy term brands field image, okay. Then the entity view is also exported, taxonomy term brands default, right. So all these configuration are being packaged now together. So what else do we want to export? How about the role? Because we need to have a speaker role at least, right? Okay, so it's there as well. So if you want to, if there happens to be some view that you create to create a list, you can also tick the list that tick the view that you want to export to. Like for example, we want to export the content view. Okay. So after doing this, what we do is we just click write. It will be generated in the modules custom event management. Let's take a look how it looks like. So you see this module, this is actually a custom module, event management. And you have the YAML configuration file ready for the module itself. There is the info YAML, or this is the feature YAML, this is the info YAML. What it does is listing all the dependencies, the modules that you need before you can actually enable this feature module. Date, time, field, image, and so on and so forth. Right. Then in terms of the configuration itself, you can take a look that everything is actually here. The talk content type is here together with the configuration. The field, let's see, the taxonomy for calibrary brands, right, is here as well. Can you all see or not? From there. Very small, right? Okay, anyway, I can't zoom in either. Okay, then just now the field taxonomy term brands image field image is here. If you remember that we actually configure the view display, and we configure the view display to use a image style thumbnail, it's all there.
Yeah.
So by exporting this module, basically you are creating a new functionality, a new module, which is event management. It serves as its own module. It becomes a custom module. You can just, if you want, you can create this kind of custom module, upload to Drupal.org. There may be other people who might find exactly the same use case as you do, right? Or what you can do, what we normally do is just that we just commit these configuration files to repository, then we just pull it in staging, then we just do a features revert. By doing a features revert, what it does is that any value that is available in the database will be overwritten by the value that is available in the file. Okay, right. To give you an example, let's say that it is no longer a image style thumbnail, right? Let's say that it is a image style large. Open. Okay, let's see whether is there image style large configuration. Image styles large. Large, there is, okay. So if I go to configuration now, configuration management. Configuration synchronization. Okay. Right now there is you can see that there is one change, 29 remove. Okay, so this one we probably don't care. Let's see, you can actually find the changes there, right? So I hope I've not done this before. I hope I'm doing the right thing. By changing the value here from thumbnail to just large, and then here image style large as well, right? Then let me refresh this, taxonomy term brands. Display, yeah, it doesn't really show. Ah, okay, I know why. It's because I have not enabled this particular module. Yeah. So if I go to the module list itself, event management, I enable it first. Now by right, you should be able to see the differences of the two configuration, in two different places. One is under the features page. That's what happened in Drupal 7 actually. But Drupal 8, there should be that additional page that we saw earlier, configuration synchronization. We should be able to see it here. Taxonomy. View mode. View image. Okay, let's try on the features itself. There is a change state here. Clicking on the change, you should be able to see that there are two, yeah, but it just highlights a different one actually. Yeah. Okay, so I still need to learn about this module. It's very new to me as well. I'm familiar with the one in Drupal 7. Drupal 8, not very sure yet how it actually works. In Drupal 7, we have some issues as well on things like image style, for example. It's not really exported well either. So maybe that problem still exists in Drupal 8. Need to explore further. But this is pretty much how we actually do it in real life, right? That after we configure everything in our local development machine or the development server, what we do is export it to file, commit, then we deploy it to the other servers. So that's pretty much how we build Drupal sites without writing any single line of code at all. Can we actually write, or rather there are use cases that we need to write at the minimal or at the maximum actually. What we call the form alter function. Form alter, what it does is really just to tweak how a form looks like. I don't have the time, but we can actually use Drupal console to easily create that kind of function. So like for example, Drupal module Drupal generate Drupal generate. So let's talk about if we want to create a proper Drupal 8 module with a controller, dependency injection, service container, as in accessing the service and service container and so on and so forth, right? We can use this generic controller. I think in some other platform or framework, it is called scaffolding. Okay, name of the module. My module, we can also install autocomplete here. So when I type my, it just autocomplete. Enter the control class name, default controller. Enter the control method title, load. Okay. Enter the method name, hello. Enter the root path, is my module 2, my module hello 3, for example. Then the parameter. Okay. So that's it. Okay, I don't want to write anything else. Do you want to generate unit test class? Even generate the unit test class for us. You want to load services from the container? Let's say we say yes. So what services do we want? Database, what else? Form builder, for example. That's it. You want to confirm generation? Yes. Okay. So what we see here, there is a new module, or the module, the custom module that I created earlier, my module, there is an additional file there. And all this line of codes, right, are generated automatically by Drupal console. So there's the good thing that if you are still learning about Drupal 8 development, you can use Drupal console to also to learn how all these things work, right? Because router is definitely moved to Symfony router already. Right, it's no longer using the menu hooks. That's what we use in Drupal 7. So yeah, let me go back to my slides. Okay, so that's the walkthrough. I hope that you learned something today. And to summarize, we talked about the Drupal way. So to create a good Drupal site, scalable Drupal site, not necessarily to always write custom modules. You can achieve that by configuring the different modules together. In fact, it is actually better. Sometimes it's better because it prioritizes security, scalability, maintainability, and performance. And always know your modules and decide, balance out between having contrib module or custom module. So that's all. Any questions? No. Okay. So how to reach me? You want to reach me? My email is sj@pixelonion.com. You can find my so-called the Drupal handler Lojiju, right? drupal.org/u/lojiju. You can find me in the Drupal Singapore Facebook page as well. And thank you for coming. Right. Yeah.